Alexander the Great remarked that the peoples of Asia were slaves because they had not learned to pronounce the word no. Let that not be the epitaph of the English-speaking people, or of parliamentary democracy, or of France, or of the many surviving liberal states of Europe. There, in one single word, is the resolve which the forces of freedom and progress, of tolerance and goodwill, there is the resolve which they should take. It is not in the power of one nation, however formidably armed. Still less is it in the power of a small group of men, violent, ruthless men, who have always, however, to cast their eyes back over their shoulders. It is not in their power to cramp and fetter the forward march of human destiny. The preponderant world forces are upon our side. They have but to be combined to be obeyed. We must arm. Britain must arm. America must arm. We shall no doubt arm. Britain, casting away the habits of centuries, will decree national service for her citizens. But arms, instrumentalities, as President Wilson called them, are not sufficient by themselves. We must add to them the power of ideas. People say, many people, we ought not to allow ourselves to be drawn into a theoretical antagonism between Nazism and democracy. But the antagonism is here, now. You see these dictators on their pedestal, surrounded by the bayonets of their soldiers and the truncheons of their police. They are afraid of words and thoughts. Words spoken abroad, thoughts stirring at home, all the more powerful because forbidden. These terrify them. A little mouse, a little tiny mouse of thought appears in the room, and even the mightiest potentates are thrown into panic. They make frantic efforts to bar out thoughts and words. They're afraid of the workings of the human mind. A state of society where men may not speak their minds, where children denounce their parents to the police, where a businessman or small shopkeeper ruins his competitor by telling tales about his private opinion. Such a state of society cannot long endure if it is brought continually in contact with the healthy outside world. The light of civilized progress, with its tolerances and cooperation, with its dignities and joys, has often been blotted out. But I hold the belief that we have now at last got far enough ahead of barbarism to control it and to avert it, if only we realize what is afoot and make up our minds in good time. Is this a call to war? Does anyone pretend that preparations for resistance against aggression amounts to the unleashing of war? I declare it to be the sole guarantee of peace, the finest and the surest prospect of peace.